I'm Midnight Agent Raw.
And I'm Okame.
We are the Super Media Bros Podcast, and we are founding members of the OddPods Media Network.
Hey, this is Russ.
This is Kyle.
This is Michelle.
From the Infectious Groove Podcast.
Join us every Monday for the most fun you can have with a music podcast. The Infectious Groove Podcast uses a positive and fun approach as we take time every week to share our jammy jams, then dig into a thought-provoking topic discussing all decades and genres of music. You can find the Infectious Groove Podcast on all major podcast platforms, or you can head to infectiousgroovepodcast.com to find us there and subscribe. We might have a controversial opinion here or there, but we always have fun with it.
Oh, I'm sure I'll say something dumb.
Subscribe to the Infectious Groove Podcast, part of the OddPods Media Network.
Diamonds in the rough.
Kings, queens, and 80's sheen.
Don't criticize us.
All that and more.
Let's jump in the time machine, dude.
And not keep us hanging on.
Super Media Bros.
Here we are in the land of the 80s.
I look behind me and there we are.
I look behind you. There you is.
Palm trees, vaporwave, and big old sun.
There we go. Even though everything in the 80s was painted fucking khaki and brown.
Yeah. Or yellow in some cases.
Piss yellow. Welcome to episode 189 of the Super Media Bros Podcast. I'm Midnight Agent Raw.
And I'm Okame.
We're just going to get right to the point. We're going to take a look and to listen at what we consider to be some hidden gems of 80s music. Now, before we really dive into it.
Disclaimers.
Yes. Hardcore 80s enthusiasts will know some of the picks that we have. Some of you may not. However, there are some qualities to our picks where maybe the song didn't chart very high, but it should have by all intents and purposes. It got passed over by other singles from the same album. It got buried in the FM radio algorithms. Seemingly forgotten by pop culture in the last three decades. I mean, the list goes on, but those are kind of there.
Well, I mean, there's also the obvious factor of overshadowing by the kings and queens of the 80s.
Exactly.
I mean, look at the queens. You got like Cyndi Lauper, Madonna, Paula Abdul, the kings, obviously Michael Jackson, and enough memeing of him, but Rick Astley is definitely, you know, quotable of the 80s.
Right.
You know, you have those types of stars that just pretty much just all over 80s radio, 80s this, 80s that. I mean, it's easy to see why a lot of our picks are, they're there, but they're not quite as prominent as the guys that, you know.
Yeah, and I mean, again, some of the picks are going to be by bands that you absolutely recognize. Hell, you might have even heard some of these songs on radio, but that doesn't necessarily mean that this shit was popular when it first came out, because some of these songs didn't even chart like they should have, or they didn't even get recognition until later on after release.
I mean, shit, a lot of these songs I was listening to on Spotify, I'm like, damn, what the hell was this? Like, I never found this shit.
Right.
And that's kind of the point. Like, some of these songs, we were like, oh my God, I hadn't heard that in a hot minute. And then there's a few that are like, really? This existed?
Yeah. And this literally all started. Like, should we go ahead and start with the thing that kicked it all off in the first place for this conversation?
I mean, might as well.
Okay. So that was you. Because I remember you texted me and you were just like, have you heard this song? And I was like, actually, I have, but it's been a fucking hot minute because holy shit. And that would be Billy Ocean's Caribbean Queen.
Caribbean Queen, now we're sharing the same dream.
Yeah, we're going to let you, like, hear some of the shit that we talk about on here. We don't give a fuck about getting demonetized on YouTube for this shit.
We don't even get monetized, period.
Exactly.
But this song, ever since I heard it last year, just instantly sticks to my brain. Like, oh my God, it's such a good vibe.
It really is. And again, I know a lot of people out there are like, well, that was one of Billy Ocean's biggest songs. Well, then why the fuck is it not being prominently used in film?
Well, I mean, you got guys like Rick Astley, who's pretty much like, bam, I'm here.
I'm never going to give you up.
Yeah, I'm not here to let you down. Oh, well, actually, I'm here to let you down.
I feel like this song is a hidden gem because of the fact that I really don't hear it talked about a whole bunch.
But see, that's the thing I was talking about earlier. Like, I didn't know this song existed until last year. And this song's obviously been out for decades. And a lot of his other music is just as good, too. But that song sticks out way more than the rest of his catalog to me.
Now, I'm going to come out swinging with a band that is immensely popular. If you are a drunk woman in a bar and any of their songs come on, chances are you fucking sing your heart out to it. However, this one's more of a fan favorite of hardcore fans of this band. And the band that I'm talking about is Journey. And the song that I'm talking about is Stone in Love. Did this song chart as high as the other singles from Escape? Nope. Why the fuck not?
Yeah, I rarely hear this one. And it was funny that you mentioned the whole the drunks in the bars, like, because that's the first thing I thought of whenever I hear a lot of these songs. Is like, they get overshadowed by those daiquiri, yeah, karaoke nights with the ladies after they get off of work at 5 p.m. They're like, I want to sing Journey. I want to sing this. I want to, like, it's literally every fucking popular hit that you can possibly throw at. And it's like, you get that one person who is no part of this group of women whatsoever. And they're like, I want to sing Billy Ocean. And you just hear
right
in the back.
Exactly. And seriously, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of people that disagree with this opinion. I don't even call it a hot take. It's just my opinion. Name me, and I know there probably are to other people, but name me a better Journey song that didn't reach number one.
And please don't say Don't Stop Believing.
Yeah.
Please don't. I'm so fucking tired of that song.
Well, you stopped believing in it, and it stopped believing in you.
Like, Lights, tired of it. Like, really, the only song that is, like, mainstay popularity is Separate Ways. I really like that song.
Well, I mean, Tron.
Yeah. But even before Tron, like,
I know.
The stupid-ass music video, everything. Just them, like, literally on a wharf, just playing their instruments on random surfaces.
And then, like, air playing and shit.
Yeah. But there's actually quite a few songs. Like, Send Her My Love is actually a good one,
too. Send Her My Love is a fucking amazing track, dude.
And I don't hear that song very often, either.
No, I don't either. And it's, yeah, you know what? That's a good one, too. Goddamn. I mean, Journey's great, but, like, these are the songs that I like.
Mm-hmm.
God.
And see, like, my direction is more so artists that I've never heard of, or most people never heard of. One that I found was Alexander O'Neill, Criticize.
This one's funky and it's dancey.
For real. Big bop on this one, man.
I'm mixing those backing vocals, dude.
Yeah.
Chef's kiss, man.
Like,
great find, by the way.
I'll admit, his vocals kind of threw me off for a second because he just, like, he had that kind of weird tone to it. But then I got more into it and I listened to it. It's like, don't criticize. I was like, okay, this is good.
What if Scott Stapp sang it?
Oh, criticize.
Don't criticize.
Don't criticize.
Yeah, don't criticize me.
But yeah, like you said, like, that has a bit of funk. It has some, like, R&B in there. And then the synths come in, backing vocals. It's an all-around package. And I've never heard of him up until, like, 2 days ago.
It's good shit, though.
Oh, yeah.
There... We have all these songs, like, clipped in place, but there is one that I found that I really dig a lot, but the intro just cracks me the fuck up.
Oh, Lord.
And it's a song called Disco Band by Scotch. Cough it up. Cough it up. Cough it up. Cough it up.
Cough it up. Cough it
up. Cock-a-doodle-d- what? But the synthesizers... Or just, yeah. Oh. explosive track.
He showed me this video for the song, and it's literally just some random white dude on a synthesizer just playing the noises he heard. Yeah, and then to his right is this guy in a full-on yellow ensemble.
Submarine.
And imagine, if you will, a very angry Steve Irwin pose. Because that is what this guy is doing. He's literally like doing some kind of jazzercise Steve Irwin pose, and he's just sitting there bopping on the stage. And then he starts singing like literally like 30 seconds into it. Like either that or he threw his back out and he's like, I'm just going to do it like this. I'm good.
Finger in the butt. Finger in the butt.
Fister in the butt.
In the butt. That'll piss it off real nice.
Woo.
No, seriously though, the song itself is really good. It's really just, again, the synthesizers in this are just, that's what moves the whole fucking thing. And the vocal mix on this one, I think is like, it's a 5 minute song.
Yeah.
Because there's a disco mix and then there's the longer vocal mix.
Yeah, the extended.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Have a glass of scotch and listen to scotch.
I mean, some people might just to kind of like, oh, I can tolerate this.
Let's take the edge off.
Mm-hmm. I don't know which one to go with next because there's a ton that I came up with. Now, there was a song that I listened to not too long ago that I was like, oh my God, this song just brings me back. I was listening to Mr. Mr. Broken Wings.
That's a fucking classic.
It's so damn good. And it's like, I don't hear it that often anymore. And it kind of saddens me. But yeah, I grew up to that song, to be honest. Like, it's such an emotional little song. Another one. The one that I found, and it brings me back to a lot of like different aspects of music, but Imagination with Just an Illusion. It's just an illusion.
Yup. Now, yeah, I was going to say, you pointed something out to me that I didn't think about until I was really listening to this. And we reviewed an EP by Ian Isaiah not long ago.
Named Auntie.
Yes. And it seems as though this could have very easily been one of their biggest influences in doing that record.
Yeah, because if you really pay attention to the vocals, like, it's very close to what Ian, how they sing. Like,
right.
Really close. And I know they probably pulled from decades of music, but I think that was a good influence for them.
Right. And it's the correct time frame, especially given the style that Ian has brought to the table with the music that they're making in general. This is a good reference point.
Yeah. But overall, like, great track. Like I said, the vocal, like, the
I know you're a bit, and I am too. Like, we're both really big into backing vocals because that can make or break a song. And even though they're not on like our list, go this is pun city, but like they're not on our list, even though Kisses are on their list. Hall & Oates are really good at making their backing vocals like right up front in the mix to make the chorus basically. They write in such a unique style that way.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, I digress. One song that I heard quite often on the radio, but I really didn't hear it a whole bunch growing up, and I didn't hear it a lot until I think maybe a year or two ago, is Harden My Heart by Quarter Flash. I'm gonna harden my heart. And I'm gonna swallow, I really dig this song for a multitude of reasons, but the biggest one being the fucking saxophone lead that comes up. Beautiful. I am a fucking sucker for saxophone in music. Give me more of it.
You know, just hearing that kind of get, I know it's a weird stretch, but just hear me out for a second. It gives me kind of a, that's, I guess, a depressing country vibe in a little bit, because the way that the guitar is kind of like keeping up the rhythm and the way she sings almost sounds very country. I guess mine works differently than most people, but I can kind of get this little twist to it.
How do I put this? The saxophone reminds me of like a noir setting. That's where my brain goes with the saxophone. But other than that, the song is a fantastic bop, if you will. I don't know that it necessarily got its due, you know, attention. I mean, I'm sure it did it's on compilations and stuff, but the fact that I grew up around a radio station and never once heard this fucking song blows my mind. So yeah.
I mean, I have like two songs. I don't know how many people actually agree with them being hidden gems per se, but if you really listen to Keep Me Hanging On by Kim Wilde, which I fucking love Kim Wilde, to be honest, but I think that one kind of comes and goes, I guess, when it comes to being played. I don't really hear her that often to begin with, but that's a really fantastic fucking track. It's like outshined by like Madonna and Paula Abdul with similar kind of style. But yeah, I can't get enough of that song.
Yeah, I feel like Kim, granted, she had hits and stuff like that, but she should have absolutely been bigger than she was. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like as an artist, I think.
I mean, she definitely had what it takes, but I just don't understand, like you said, why she didn't make it any bigger than she did.
Well, I mean, I guess some people just kind of, I don't know, I'm going to use the term fade into obscurity or just kind of fade away, but I mean, some artists like come and go. They really do. However, this artist, I believe, made a significant impact on a soundtrack of a very, very popular Joel Schumacher film. However, the song itself, for whatever reason, it's around, but I don't believe that it was huge. It's been covered so many times by so many fucking bands, which, you know, that should, you know, tell that it's good. But I feel like this has actually made a lot of people's lists of songs that should have had more recognition, or it should have done better than it did. And that's Cry Little Sister by Gerard McMahon. And a lot of people are like, oh, it's the Lost Boys theme. I mean, sure, but it's very haunting, goth, dark wave.
Just emotional as hell.
Yes, absolutely.
Because you can just hear it in his vocals, like, cry, little sister.
Now, I think I'm going to forego, like, a couple of things that I see on here. Like, however, I'm going to point out, like, maybe two or three more on my end. I know you had one from Johnny Hates Jazz. I don't know if you wanted to talk about that.
Which, again, I've never heard of these guys until now.
And that song is Shattered Dreams.
Such a smooth. Oh. Oh, yes. It's so smooth and just simple.
Right.
At the same time, like, you can't go wrong with that one.
No.
And like I said, this is one of those artists that I was just literally going through a random playlist and they appeared and I'm like, how have I not heard this? Because, like, I literally went through, like, all childhood, all through my adulthood up until now, and where was this one at?
Right.
But, again, goes back to what I said. I mean, everybody else of the 80s is just like, nope, we're popular. Fuck y'all.
And see, there's a band that came out in the early 80s, and I think they only did three albums. And the band is called Kano. Yes, like the Mortal Kombat character, but obviously way before that.
Mm-hmm.
And this song came from their last album, and it's the title track, and it's called Another Life. But holy shit, it's really good. Y'all, look. This shit? Just drop me into wherever this is happening and leave me the fuck there. I will vibe to this all goddamn day. Exactly. Just fucking jam. And the fact that this song is like, no bullshit. Like, I don't really know anybody has ever like mentioned that band or that song in particular. So in my opinion, that's a literal gem. That fucker is buried.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you have actually heard that song, I would love for you to put something in either the comments on YouTube, if this video is actually going to still be available, or come find us on Twitter and at us and just be like, hey, I've heard of this song, motherfucker. Who the hell are you?
Are you a true 80s fan?
Yeah, no shit. Yeah, I've heard of Kano. Have you ever heard of Liu Kang?
Oh my God.
What?
Have you heard of Liu Kang?
Have you heard of Liu Kang? He did that fucking Wang Chung tonight. Everybody have fun tonight song. It's like, nobody, that was Wang Chung. But thank you for trying. So I've been thinking about going back to college.
Oh yeah, what are you going to study?
The female anatomy.
Good choice.
Thanks.
But there's got to be more to college than certain curves.
And no, we're not talking about the grading curve. It's back to school time, and we want to make sure you pack the essentials to have the best year yet.
Wait. Is this a pop quiz? I wasn't ready for this.
No, it's not a pop quiz. But if you'd like to be the valedictorian of ball trimming, join the 2 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped by going to manscaped.com using the code SUPER.
Teacher, what all comes with being a valedictorian?
Well, first off, the Performance Package 4.0 from Manscaped is here to teach the boys a lesson on male hygiene. Inside, you'll find the Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, the Weed Whacker ear and nose hair trimmer, Crop Preserver ball deodorant.
Wait, hold on, teacher, hold on. I'm still writing this stuff down. You speak too fast.
The Crop Reviver toner, plus two free gifts, the Performance Boxer Briefs and the Shed Travel Bag.
Will there be extra points if I wear the boxer briefs?
I mean, yeah, but it'll also give you the confidence to do anything you desire. New year, new you.
And new ladies.
That's right. This fourth generation trimmer features a cutting edge ceramic blade to reduce grooming accidents thanks to their advanced skin safe technology. It also allows you to shave your pencil down and customize your trim through additional guard lengths with sizes 1-4.
So wait, is it like A is a 1, B is a 2, C is a 3? Like, is that the grading scale for this?
Precisely. The Lawnmower 4.0 also has a 7,000 RPM motor, a new multifunction on-off switch that will engage a travel lock, and it gives you the ability to turn the 4,000K LED spotlight on and off when needed for a more precise shave.
It's actually going to be pretty good, you know, when I'm going to those night parties and I can't see stuff because they have all the lights off.
This is true, and, you know, just in case you happen to spill a drink or anything like that, it's also a waterproof trimmer. This package also comes with the Weed Whacker to chop your worst weeds up top in both your nose and ear. The Weed Whacker is also waterproof and uses a 9,000 RPM motor-powered 360-degree rotary dual blade system. This nose and ear hair trimmer provides proprietary skin-safe technology, which helps prevent nicks, snags, and tugs in the delicate places on your body.
This thing is more impressive than my laptop.
I know, and you spent a lot of money on that thing.
Yeah, like $5,000.
After trimming your pubes and cleaning your holes, show them some love with the Manscaped liquid formulations. The Crop Preserver Ball Deodorant and Crop Reviver Ball Toner are here to get you ready for class during the day and ready to party at night.
Sounds like some chemistry going on.
That's the best kind of chemistry. Manscaped also throws in their two free gifts to the Performance Package 4.0, the Manscaped Boxers and the Shed Travel Bag. One is a comfy front pack for your balls and the other is a backpack for your goods.
But which is which?
You have front and back balls? That's an odd medical condition. Well, if you'd like to spend less money than your laptop was worth, get 20% off and free shipping by going to manscaped.com using the code SUPER at checkout. That's 20% off with free shipping using our code SUPER at manscaped.com.
Or you can spend less money than college tuition.
This year, graduate with a degree and clean balls from Manscaped.
Is this all on the test?
Yes. Now, to go along with another thing that I felt like was a gem, just because this was a vocal group that was mostly doing like Motown style shit and then like doo-wop or whatever. It's a group called The Whispers, and there's a song they did in 1987 or 88 called Rocksteady. Yes, and I am all about this shit. It fucking moves, it grooves, and I want to do that fucking dance where I like go to the side and then I switch and then I go to the other side and shimmy.
Reminds me of what was it, disco from earlier, just him doing that little,
like he's all hunched over and shit. Yeah,
like that's the vibe I got when I'm dancing to it.
He's hunched over like a rock. Yeah. And he's steady.
I'm steady.
God.
But yeah, that one's a good one too. Like, yeah, that Motown vocals and. Yeah.
But what I like about it is that it's exactly that. But what I like the most about it is the fact that it felt like it was combining at the time what was current, like with the instrumentation and things like that.
Some old and something new.
Right.
At the time.
Yes. Now, there's another song called Dance With Me by Alphaville. Now, I'll admit I've actually never heard of this, but I dig the shit out of it. Now, I will probably get shot for this by the world's biggest Alphaville fan.
I'm about to say, don't come at us, please. Like, we're not doing this to piss y'all off. We're just like, hey, we're finding shit that we have spent all of our lives just not ignoring per se, but just missing out on.
Yeah, I don't want to get shot by the world's biggest Alphaville fan, but that gives me serious We Built This City vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And I unabashedly love that fucking song. Now, I probably will get shot for that.
Yeah.
But I fucking love We Built This City.
Like I said, again, quit going at us. We don't care. Y'all should know at this point that we're not fazed.
No. Now, the last two, before I feel like we'll get to an honorable mentions list, both of these are prominent metal bands, prominent rock bands. However, I've noticed something, and I've noticed this trending big time. Some bands like these two that I'm going to mention, they had flops, I would guess, in the 80s and the mid 80s, or they didn't chart as well, or the album didn't do as hot as it should have, so they just don't play some of these songs anymore. Which one of these bands still plays this song, and the other band just hasn't played this fucking song probably since the tour it was from. The first one I'm going to play is Turbo Lover by Judas Priest. Fucking love Rob Halford. A big reason I liked this one was the synthesizer work. And it's like, how can we make that thumping like doo, 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 doo. You know, how can we make like the 80s, you know, thing? Well, at the time it was not like, oh, it's not retro, but how can we like spice it up a little bit? We're Judas Priest. We're breaking the law. We're living after midnight. I need a Turbo Lover now. I've got some trivia about this song, dude. Mm. Or about the album that this song was from. Now, did you know that they turned down a spot on the Top Gun soundtrack?
I mean, with that song, they should have actually been on there.
They offered three songs, and then I can't remember which song it was. It was the closing track to the album that this song is on. But if they would have put the song on the Top Gun soundtrack, they wouldn't have been able to contractually put the song on their studio album, so they just didn't do it. And now, I think as of a few years ago, Rob Halford did an interview. He was like, yeah, we kind of regret doing that because the Top Gun soundtrack is one of the best fucking movie soundtracks of all time.
And Kenny Loggins is pretty much the king of that soundtrack.
Yep.
Danger Zone.
I think Turbo Lover, or hell, any fucking track from that album would have fit really well. Now, my last band, the album that this came from, Fly on the Wall, was probably at the time, and probably still is to this day, one of their heavier albums, and that's AC/DC. And the song is called Shake Your Foundations. The production work on this song and the album in general sounds nothing like the rest of their albums did. And the guitar work is probably more, it's closer to metal sounding than a lot of their stuff is, because Angus plays real bluesy. I mean, it's still prevalent in that song, but a lot of the stuff they did on that album was just vastly underrated. And I feel like that song should have been bigger than it was, like big time. They don't even play it live anymore. Like, I think the last time they played it was on their tour for this album.
I don't disagree with you at all about that song, but like, I think I've faded out with interest with AC/DC over the years. Cause in my mind, a lot of their music is really too similar for me to get into. Like, you know, obviously they had their hits and everything like that, but I'm just still not an AC/DC fan anymore, to be honest. And I'm probably going to get flack for that shit, but like, I don't give a fuck. You know, everybody has their taste in music.
Right, right.
I'm not afraid to open my mouth and speak my mind about it, but yeah, I'm done with AC/DC. I'm kind of getting done with Journey, to be honest.
And I'm of the mindset where, like, AC/DC, yeah, granted, they probably should have hung it up by now. Like, Power Up was pretty good. Like, their most recent release was really good. But, you know, I know that that is one of those bands that has that, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And, I mean, they've had a pretty fucking successful career. So, I mean, the shit that they did in the 80s, like, when Who Made Who came out after this album, which that was, I think, one of the songs that maybe kind of revitalized them a little bit in that era. But again, I think Fly on the Wall was probably one of their more underrated albums. And there's some honorable mentions. And whenever I say, like, honorable mentions, they're both artists, but, like, one is just an artist in particular. And then one is, like, a set of albums. The Egyptian Lover. Goddamn. Okay. Everybody was like, oh, fucking Sir Mix-a-Lot. Sure. Yeah. Fuck yeah, Sir Mix-a-Lot. But goddamn, Egyptian Lover. I love that dude. And I always crack up because a friend of mine and I noticed something about his music that I can never unhear. He breathes. He breathes a lot. And I know what you're thinking. Yeah, motherfucker. Doesn't everybody breathe? Yeah, but his entire, like, thing, you hear, like, and that's the thing. And it's fucking funny.
It just reminds me, like, Salt and Pepper. It's like, ah, smell shit.
Ah, my toe. Ah, stubbed it. Ah, my breath. Well, the other thing I'm going to mention as an honorable mention are three of Rush's albums from the mid-80s. Now, I know for a fact that everybody that hears the name Rush, hey, Moving Pictures, Tom Sawyer. Hey, 2112. Actually, I would love to meet people that were like, hey, Rush, 2112. That's my favorite Rush album, like, ever. But
they have that same syndrome when it comes to Journey. It's like YYZ, Limelight, Tom Sawyer. Like, just, okay, get away from those. Let's focus on the actual shit that they put out.
I will give you three albums. If you're a Rush fan or you like Rush and you have not heard anything outside of Spirit of Radio, like, if that's as far as you've gone into their discography, I challenge you. No, fuck that. I implore you.
We demand
that you check out Grace Under Pressure, Power Windows, and Hold Your Fire. Those three albums are fucking underrated as hell. And to me, those deserve hidden gem status because holy fuck.
Yeah, because like I said, there's the three, now four, prominent songs of their career that literally every radio station plays. Everybody sings along to. Everybody's like, Rush, oh yeah, them. It's like, come on, y'all. Like, they're not just those four songs.
No, not at all. In fact, it's crazy because Rush had that, them and AC/DC kind of had like a little parallel. Like, their last successful album was like in 1981 at that point in time. Not that their other shit wasn't successful. Like, it was enough to get them on tours and they stayed on, you know, radio and TV and shit.
Right.
But like, AC/DC didn't have like a, hey, we're getting back into the swing of shit until the Blow Up Your Video album in 1988 and then fucking Razor's Edge with Thunderstruck and Money Talks in 1990. Now, Rush eventually came back fucking swinging whenever Counterparts had come out. And I think Roll the Bones actually was their first album into the 90s. And then they'd had like Counterparts and then Test for Echo. And then when Vapor Trails came out in like 2002, that's when they had their really huge fucking resurgence up until Neil Peart's death.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, if you really want to sit and check out some good shit, go check those three Rush albums out. You won't be fucking disappointed. And if you are disappointed, come find me and kick me in the dick.
Or just challenge me and him to, like, why do you not like these albums? Like, give us actual reasoning and then we'll just tell you you're still wrong.
You'll be rushing for the front door because we're going to be kicking your ass out of our houses.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck you.
Brush with death.
A rush. You're going to get a rush of death.
Yeah.
We'll bum rush you.
Oof.
Get out of the house. We probably could have sat here all fucking night, but that would be too big of a list.
And y'all don't want to hear us talk for like 2 to 3 hours.
Fuck no. If there is a song or artist that did not make this list, please chime in the comments below or on our social media platforms.
Yeah, I would love to hear, just in my mind, like, new 80s sounds that I've never heard before. Like I was telling y'all earlier, some of these guys I've just discovered recently, and I'm just kicking myself in the ass for the last like couple of decades.
Right.
Where are these people at? Where are these bands at that I've just now discovered? So yeah, give me suggestions. Like, who do y'all listen to that literally nobody else listens to?
Yeah, exactly. Because I would like to hear them too. I would like to think. Now, granted, we're confined into a decade and we're confined to certain songs and shit. I would like to think that we are pretty musically knowledgeable, but we always want to hear new shit.
I mean, shit, every day, like, we're texting each other, like, oh, this song, oh, that band, oh, that album. We literally discover shit every fucking day, but this is like, okay, there's a gold mine that we just skipped over.
Oh, yeah, and the fact that we really didn't get into the foreign market. I mean, some of these artists, like Kano, came from overseas, but we didn't really dig into the foreign market territory as deeply as we probably could have. Like, I'll be honest, like, and I didn't even think to mention this earlier, but fucking Andy and Karas with Strangelove, I know this is going to be obscure to everybody out there, but this was the theme song to the film, or the love theme to Samurai Cop, but the song itself is really fucking good. So check that out. Maybe that'll be another honorable mention.
Just throw it in there.
That's right. So if you'd like to listen to past, present, and future episodes of our show, check out supermediabrospodcast.com. Leave us a rating and review on Podchaser and Apple Podcasts. Subscribe to us on YouTube. Follow us on social media. All of this is in the show notes below. Check out all the other shows on the OddPods Media Network. And for the love of everything, go buy a shirt.
Just one.
Just buy one shirt.
You can buy 5 or 6 shirts.
Or just one. I don't like sleeves. They disappoint me.
Oh my God.
That's why you buy a tank top.
Yeah.
You could buy 5 or 6 tank tops. Or just one. But anyway, I am tapped the fuck out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to go listen to some music and relax. I'm going to go listen to more shit. Take out my shovel and start digging for more music.
It'll be like Wayne Knight in Space Jam.
Where are you? It's like looking down the fucking looking down the golf hole. I need you to come out now.
Yeah. So all these great songs. Yeah,
we need you to come out.
Where are you, Michael?
We're over here. All right, guys. Thank you so much for listening this week. That was Hidden Gems of 80s Music, episode 189. Until next week, I've been Midnight Agent Raw.
And I'm Okame.
Shades on.
No more love on the run.